by historians of urban vacant land is very surprising. Let me say that I define wasteland, vacant land, definitions all, as unbuilt, untended, and uncultivated space. Well, as I said, the neglect by historians is surprising, because since the 60s and 70s, there's been an outpouring of research on the subject by social scientists, lawyers, ecologists, and of the many issues discussed, the causes, types, and extent of wasteland figure prominently, along with the impact on health, neighbourhoods, the economy and property market, the environmental implications for climate change and biodiversity, and the potential uses. So there is a big literature in the social sciences and the environmental and natural sciences on vacant land. From the 70s, and particularly the 80s, the period saw policy makers increase in Western Europe and America increasingly concerned with wasteland, which was seen as emblematic of post-industrial decline. In the 1980s, there was considerable political debate in Britain and France, and I'd be interested if people know anything about the discussions in Spain. Nor is the interest in vacant or wasteland confined to social scientists and policymakers. There is an important cultural aspect dimension to the story. We have many cinematic depictions of urban vacant space, from American films of the 1930s to French and Italian productions of the post-war period, notably Marcel Carné's Terrain Vague in 1960, which I think is this one. And then this was a famous prize-winning documentary on Rio, West Sites Around Rio, which is this one. And there are many literary references in the writings of Victor Hugo, Dickens, Charles Dickens, Zola, Simenon. Georges Simenon frequently describes wasteland in and around Paris. Such dystopian space is usually seen as symptomatic of a lack of identity and moral direction in society. So how do we explain why historians have neglected what is a very important subject? Firstly, there are problems of terminology. In cities before 1900, we have a great variety of terms used, including vacant land or vacant ground or empty ground or waste ground. In the urban context, in the English, in the British or the Anglophone context, you would say, wasteland as a term really dates mainly from the late 19th century. Before then, wasteland was usually referred to in rural situations or in the colonies, in the British colonies, in relation to agricultural improvement. And the French term terrain vague originates around or after 1900. Before that, friche was generally used in both urban and rural contexts, and friche has now come back into fashion for this, and terrain vague has come up. More recently, wasteland has had to compete, at least in the Anglophone literature, with many other synonyms: urban voids, dead spaces, interim spaces, edge land, derelict zone, remnant parcels. However, if we use vacant land or wasteland as umbrella terms, we will see that they cover many different kinds of empty space. And this could be illustrated by looking at maps and landscapes from the 17th century for Paris and Vienna and Stockholm, and you can see this empty space. Of course, this is in a way the zone outside Paris, outside the fortifications, we can see a lot of empty space by this is what did I say? Vienna. Yes, of course. By the port here, and you can see empty space all around Stockholm here on the islands and so on, although within the city limits. Thank you again for the lovely poster, but this is also, I think, from Madrid. I found on the web a drawing of Wasteland in Madrid. Basically, there are three main categories, it seems to me, of wasteland. Firstly, what one could call a structural vacant land. For instance, around the castles, as you can see up there, because of this need to for firing purposes. This is Lisbon, of course, with this built on this promontory here, with a lot of wasteland. Wasteland for military purposes, marshland, we talked a bit this morning about rivers and so on, and marshland by rivers or by the sea is important. Also, rocky, this is Helsinki, it's a map of late 19th century Helsinki, it's built on granite, and major parts of the city in the late 19th century were not built over because you can see here these rock formations which they didn't have the technology to remove. We also find wasteland near ports and railway lines and major areas of wasteland around railway stations. And later here, this is Ostrava, where I was a couple of years ago, and this is leading to the motorway. You can see a lot of wasteland. So this this type of vacant, structural vacant land is essentially long term. A second sort of wasteland is produced by by economic transformation. So to give two examples, I'll give a picture later on. In the late Middle Ages, the decline of urban populations in cities led to large empty spaces within cities, maybe 20% of cities, and the even Paris, and the restructuring of urban European urban cities since the 1970s linked to suburbanisation, slum clearance, and transport changes also generated a lot of this. This is Oscar. This is Ostrava, again, and there they've converted this area to car parking. Thirdly, a third sort of wasteland is what one could call crisis wasteland or vacant land due to natural or man-made disasters. So, obviously, this is Lisbon, Lisbon after the earthquake in 1755, when 80% of the city is demolished, and of course then in recent times warfare has led to destruction of cities. I think this is Berlin in 1945. So there's a problem of definition, and you need to really think of three different types of wasteland. And the last type, this is so short, this crisis wasteland, it's essentially short term, often rebuilding after 15 years or so. Another terminological issue is related. So I think with wasteland, vacant land, we need to be very careful at trying to define it. Because one of the difficulties is that vacant land can overlap with other types of urban space, for instance, gardens. In London in 1415, the city had what was called the moor, the nowadays Moorfields, which is part of just by the old city of London, they said, the city said in 1415, this piece of land had been at one time changed into a garden and at another time into a vacant piece of land, and so repeatedly altered and changed. So one of the problems with wasteland is it doesn't stay, it changes. And then there's the same kind of overlap is noted in the 19th century with waste sites in cities referred to also as gardens. In England, wasteland overlaps often with town commons, so we see the famous Clapham Common in London, which you can see is basically wasteland unbuilt. Okay, again, vacant land can vary greatly in size from large tracts, I'll give a picture later, the urban prairies of decayed US cities like Detroit, down to very small plots, strips, and blocks of land. And there's a lot of data on American cities showing this great variety of sizes and shapes of empty space. Yet for all the differences of time, and scale, and context, most vacant or waste areas share certain common features. Largely unbuilt and uncultivated, spaces of transition, ambiguity, and generally they're owned by somebody, whether public or private, but often there's uncertainty or passivity in the ownership. Some are railed or boarded off, but others are open space. Frequently they are seen as places outside official control or barely controlled, like the zone. Often they are conflictual spaces contested by owners, the authorities, planners, neighbours and users. Up to a point they are alternative spaces for popular and illicit activities vital for the little discourses of urban life. Finally, wasteland is distinctive for its varying functions, its different uses, its lack of specials. And I think this is a contrast really to official urban spaces, which tend by the modern period anyway, or the contemporary period, towards specialist exclusive functions. So open space, vacant spaces, multifunctional in a way that modern official spaces tend to be increasingly exclusive. So I think the importance of the subject is I hope already evident, and what we can see is that the areas of wasteland at different times are very substantial in cities, between 10 and 30% of urban land. And I'll give some figures, some documentation for that in a minute. So let's get on to the... So that, by way of showing how complicated the subject is, I want now to turn to changes over time, and because you're not medievalists, you either need to be forget about this, or and I will try and go over it quickly. But what we can be sure of is that in early cities in Europe, the area of wasteland was very considerable. What we know now increasingly about European cities is that they begin as multi-centred. So they are an area where you have an abbey, a religious house, you have a castle, you have maybe burgesses, a market for burgesses. So you have different centres with a lot of empty space between them. And that space is then built over increasingly in the 13th century. So at Norwich, this is Norwich, which is a major city in eastern England. Some of you maybe have heard of it, and a bit like a regional centre like Balladwood is. And what we know about it is that there were important areas underdeveloped, and right in the centre of the city, for instance, here, no, sorry, excuse me, here, we know that this area was very marshy in the 10th century, and it was called Empty or Vacant Land, and it was only built over after that, and that's where the city town hall is now based. This area by the river here was also very underdeveloped. And then you can see around the castle here, this important zone, as it were, so you could see. And then, of course, in the Middle Ages, we find earthquakes and fires very often, and inundations creating this. In the late Middle Ages, this was just to illustrate, because the European urban economy generally contracts, populations anyway contract. And this is Leicester, which some of you have visited, and in the 15th century. And in the 14th century, before the Black Death, most of the city was occupied, and this area in particular had quite dense occupation. But in the by the end of the 15th century, this area had become largely vacant, an empty space, and the population was concentrated in this area, and after that they built a new market, which is the market which is in Leicester, the main market now. So the markets moved and the population moved back. Renewed population growth in the 16th and early 17th centuries may have led to a decline in the overall volume of urban vacant land because of densification. So we know that in the case of London, the areas which were empty in the 15th century get filled up again in the 16th century. But even so, we find survival of areas of vacant or wasteland within cities, within towns, between houses, on the outskirts of towns and near port areas, as we saw before. In Oxford, in the mid-17th century, some research I did showed that 10% of city-owned properties were empty, were void ground. And while, as I said, central areas of later Tudor and early Stuart London were increasingly built over, the suburban areas included tracts of empty space. And here one can see the role of market speculation, uncertainty over ownership, and the problem of plots, including difficult geophysical features. So you have some, as it were, planning problems, but some political problems also contributed, such as the Reformation in Northern and Western Europe, which led to the destruction of many religious buildings, some of which stayed empty for decades. They were usually demolished and then the land. Advances in warfare and increasing deployment of cannon led to a new way from the 15th century into the 16th and 17th of urban fortifications, urban fortresses. And you can see this, I think, is Milan. Taking 15 years. The Great Fire of London cleared about 200 hectares, including of the city within the walls. From the 17th century, the mid-17th century, urban recession returned to a good part of Europe, and notably the Mediterranean. And so in the 18th century, there are many references, visitors coming to Italian cities describing the empty spaces, like Verona in the 1730s was said to have many empty spaces. So it's quite often the case, again in the early 18th century, that in southern Europe you find empty spaces. A city, and maybe you know about Spanish cities at that time. Even in the English towns, which saw from the late 17th century extended period, unique in Europe, of urbanisation, there continued to be plenty of vacant land. And this is the town of King's Lynn in far from Norwich in eastern England. And you can see this is a map from 1725, which suggests something like 15% of the town area. You can see the walls are there, but you can see how much is actually empty space. In addition, of course, a crisis made. Even in London, we know that there were important descriptions of important areas of vacant ground in the city, in the old city. In addition, crisis made empty space continue to be an important feature. And so this famous earthquake in Lisbon, which I mentioned before, as well as urban fires continuing to generate empty ground. According to Martin Kerner, very interesting book, the period of reconstruction after natural calamities like fires and earthquakes was between 10 and 40 years, so leaving large areas of vacant land for a considerable time. We move to the bottom area. With urban growth in the 19th century, some types of vacant land disappeared and new kinds emerged. Urban sprawl ensured that densification was variable, with a great deal of wasteland on the suburban periphery. As John Macaulay commented on London in 1866, in the ever-increasing spread of the metropolis, a girdling fringe, he calls it, a girdling fringe of wasteland encompasses it on all sides, and this was often due to speculation and building cycles leaving large empty spaces in the new suburbs. And this is actually, I think, from an American city, but you can see what a lot of suburban development was like. The plots were laid out, and streets probably made, but without services. And then people, one or two houses went up, and other plots stayed. And I lived I had for many years a house in Leicester, and it was in a Victorian suburb. And it was clear from the architectural styles that houses were built over something like 40 years, and plots could be looked at about plots. A lot of plots stayed empty for a long time. So we should not think of suburbanisation as in the modern way as a kind of continuous, coherent project. It was actually very fragmented, very taking place often over very long periods of time, with a lot of empty space, wasteland left. So that's that middle example. Another development, of course, is embankment of rivers. I mean, this is already starting in the river development, starting in redevelopment in the 19th century. And this is the Victoria embankment in London. But the thing about this embankment was that it took 30 years for it to be finished. And there were large areas of wasteland, and I think you can see it here, which were empty, and which were squatters and whatever people there. And the the authorities didn't seem to be able to do anything with it for a long time. Another sort of town fortifications are phased out and so on, but new public buildings also, when they were put up, had areas of wasteland. So this is a town library in a Midlands town, and then you have this big patch of empty land around. Railway construction, we heard something about railways, led to large areas of empty space. Define the bit of railways. As you can see here, because we needed space for coal to be stored, but more important, there's a risk of fire. Fire engines, so from the locomotives, from steam engines. So you always had to buy the tracks or whatever, you always had those spaces. And then you also needed large empty spaces around because most of the goods being brought were being brought by wagons and coaches, horses and wagons, and they had to be kept somewhere until the goods arrived. And so the goods, of course, had to be stored somewhere as well, but that's not usual wasteland. But we see that. But another important result of the Industrial Revolution, of course, industrialisation, is a point I made this morning. That this is a picture from Prague, these are both from Prague. You can see this huge area of empty space around this factory where waste, industrial waste, was dumped. And you see a similar picture there. Natural calamities continue to create urban wasteland in modern cities, usually for shorter periods. By contrast, war had a more devastating effect, laying waste large parts of Belgian and northern French cities during the First World War. And this is Leuven, and if you go to Leuven now, of course, it's all rebuilt. It was actually only rebuilt, finally, this square, in the 1930s. There was such an extended delay, so this was, parts of this were empty, vacant land for a long time. And then, of course, we know about the impact of Nazi and Allied bombing in Europe. In the late 20th century, some more illustrations. This is economic transformation due to industrialization. And you see this kind of urban prairie effect in a typical American industrial rust belt city. So even now, 50% of North American city land lies vacant, as it says here, a mixture of abandoned housing, open space, and ground floor sites. Just to give one example, in 2001, the city of Philadelphia, had 31,000 vacant lots, and in addition to that, demolished lots, and 26,000 abandoned houses, which will eventually go down. In Europe, the picture is not so bleak, but a detailed study that was done for East London in the 1970s was found that 15% of the area of this part of East London was empty land, a derelict and waste land. This is a map, it's not very, it was sent to me by an Irish friend, so I apologise for the quality of it, but these places here, this is central Dublin, so this is the main river, those of you know Dublin, and so these are all empty this is vacant land in 1985, so you see how important it was. And this is Ostrava. I went to Ostrava a couple of years ago, and a map by the city authorities, and the blue areas are all extensive areas of Westland. It's an old, some of you know, old industrial city. One of the problems, of course, is that one problem is contamination of land due to industrial pollution, and that makes recovery, recuperation, all these issues much more difficult. Then you've got this, what we've heard about this morning, the great land holdings around railway stations and so on. This is King's Cross in London before redevelopment, which was a huge area of empty space. The railway station, I think, is somewhere there. But you see similar things near canals, dockyards, and public utilities. And then with the just to give an example, Chicago, up to 28% of the the waterfront of the main part of the city of Chicago in the 1980s was vacant land. King's Cross, which I was mentioning, had 65 hectares of wasteland around it. The problem what to do with domestic waste has a long history, but the leap in private consumption in the late 20th century spawned a monster challenge which authorities found difficult to contain. But Naples in 2008 was invaded by 400,000 tons of waste, which overwhelmed landfills and illegal sites and so on, spread across the city. So you have kind of neighborhood waste sites. In New York, the Staten Island landfill site, now converted into a park, covered something like 1,500 hectares in 1989, as mounds of broken earth stretch in all directions. So how has public policy reflected and affected these developments over time? I won't have much time to talk about that, but I want just to say something about this. There's been very little systematic official discussion of discussion of vacant land in the pre-modern period. Rather, from the Middle Ages onwards, we hear sporadic civic and elite complaints of vacant land as a place for criminals to meet, for the poor and disorderly to shelter, probably shanty towns housing, for prostitutes to trade and for rubbish to be dumped. At the same time, towns also did recognise the value of vacant land for urban development and so on, as we saw in the case of Norwich, that vacant land right in the centre is frequently the case in the Middle Ages. What they do with these problem areas of vacant land, marshland in the centres, is to dump waste there, to fill it up and consolidate it, and then to build on top. By the 19th century, we find an increasingly pessimistic attitude. And it's this, I think, this is the time when wasteland, as a term, urban wasteland, comes into vogue. It's seen as obstructing development, a venue of the dangerous working class, and damaging to the community's image. And for instance, the city beautiful movement in the 1900 in the US targeted one of its, has an agenda of the City Beautiful Movement, as you know, and one of the things it targets is wasteland. And as we've noted already, in the late 20th century, urban deindustrialization and decentralization led to mounting public and political anxiety about waste, wasteland as symbolic of the failures of the post-industrial city. However, since the 1980s, a more balanced policy approach seems to become in vogue, in fashion, with urban vacant land seen both as a challenge, but also very clearly as an opportunity. And I won't give you the examples I've got, but for instance, in Barcelona, city officials noted that large free areas, they called it free areas, not empty space or poison, free areas play a balancing role in the transformation of a compact city. And a UK report also called on the need to see urban wasteland as a resource. So in the last part of this lecture, I want to outline some aspects of wasteland as an urban resource, because I think we need to be have a really quite a positive view of the dividends from urban wasteland. Firstly, as we've seen, vacant or wasteland has often been an important land bank for cities, providing the flexibility of accessible land for the construction of housing and public or commercial new public or commercial buildings. After catastrophes, the extent of wasteland enabled large-scale urban reconstruction and regeneration projects devastated by earthquake in the 1750s. The centre of Lisbon, as you all know, was rebuilt by the Marquês de Pombal on a grid pattern with wide streets and classical style architecture befitting an Enlightenment city. So wasteland can actually be an opportunity for modernisation. Also, from early times, wasteland and its debris was appropriated or recycled by poorer folk for shelter, shacks, huts, shanty towns, as we see in Manchester during the 17th century, in South London in the early Victorian period, in North American cities around 1900, in Paris, and before and after the First World War. Noel has many other examples, and of course in Third World cities now. Secondly, vacant land, so this is the zone. This is around Paris. Secondly, vacant land is a major economic resource, empty ground both within and outside town walls and between double or sand. Was frequently employed in the pre-modern period for gardens and orchards and for keeping animals. In the Middle Ages, it was an important food reservoir in case of attack. Sheep, cows and horses are also found grazing on vacant land in and around late Victorian cities. After the 1840s, British railway companies owned this extensive land by railway tracks, as I said, and they allowed their workmen to cultivate vegetable allotments there. At the start of the 20th century, town councils and voluntary bodies in British and North American cities took over vacant land to set the unemployed on allotment work. In the later 20th century, vacant plots have been converted, as many of you know, into community gardens. So there are 500 community gardens in present-day Philadelphia, and there's a big literature on community gardens in American cities at the present time. But many are on wasteland, on which so there's a big problem of these developments being temporary and that's. And wasteland also turned into small parks, ecological parks. Moreover, vacant or wasteland has always had a significant industrial function. I mentioned wasteland needed for modern industrial developments, factories and so on, but we also find it in the medieval period. Medieval potteries had large areas nearby for dumping shards and other production debris, dye houses, tanning and other polluting trades also needed vacant land. and so on. But it's clear that with large-scale mining and industrialisation, the demand for vacant land for dumping purposes grew exponentially. So here you can see they're using this for the textiles. This is, you can see this is the potter with his waste out there. And this is the part of Pas-de-Calais with its industrial waste, coal land. Wasteland is more than that. Waste artisans and small firms use vacant land as a place to store tools and raw materials such as timber and coals, particularly in lots of 19th century examples. Carters, people involved in the transport business, often put their carts, vans and horses overnight on bits of wasteland near where they live. And all kinds of other commercial activity took place there, including auctions, markets, sales and fairs. And since the First World War, vacant land, as we saw earlier, has been widely used as temporary car parking by shoppers, business and others. And scavengers have crawled through urban waste and waste sites since early times and up to the present day. And I was in very briefly in Ostrava, and you've heard already, and I was driving on the motorway or being driven, and I saw this enormous waste site by the motorway there, and waste tipping area, and lo and behold, I found scavengers working there, so even in 2017. Vacant ground is also an important environmental, social and cultural resource. Public and private latrines were often erected in the empty space near to town halls. As the collection of urban waste became better organised from the 16th century, carts often dumped urban waste, human waste, on vacant or empty land on the city outskirts. Vacant land was often entwined with natural calamities, and you find mass burials, for instance, in London after the Great Plague in the 1660s, on waste sites. It's also a wasteland and refuge for victims of catastrophes like the Great Fire in London in 1666, or the Great Turkish Earthquake of 1999. It also remains an important focus of sociability. Here we are, catching up now. Local people go there to chat, to drink, to walk dogs, to beat carpets and hang out laundry. Justifying the recurrent fear of authorities, criminals frequently use wasteland for meetings for murdering victims and concealing stolen properties. Gangs, of course, fought there, and drug dealers have often traded there. However, wasteland was also important for traditional popular and communal activities. Images show hunting and other games on common land outside London walls as well. In the Low Countries, we have shooting matches on vacant land outside the town walls. In 1762, bull baiting. See, the English also were involved in bull baiting and so on. There was a bull baiting on vacant ground, just more or less where the British Museum is now, which was watched by 2,000 spectators. Football matches were also played on vacant ground on the outskirts of towns. And many other alternative activities took place, including, of course, sex and prostitution, drinking and betting. And this is Helsinki, where people drinking on wasteland, probably, I think, in Kallio, but maybe by the river, by the water, in a period when drinking, public drinking was banned. In the 19th century, vacant lands were also places for radicals to mobilise, for trade unionists to protest, strikers, and so on. One important point is that we should remember that children young people use and have used Wasteland on quite a large scale, heavily policed from the 19th century in official spaces such as streets and parks. Young people often have recourse to vaping, so they're forced off the streets by policing, and they move to vacant or wasteland for games. So this is a picture of Antwerp with children playing by the old fortifications of Antwerp. Bomb sites, of course, were famous as adventure playgrounds for children of all ages. And contemporary studies show that for young people, waste ground remains one of the most essential terrains of the modern city to make dens, play with friends, come into contact with nature, and experience solitude. Finally, wasteland is an important ecological resource for cities, and most work by ecologists has highlighted the way that vacant ground sustains a wide range of eco system service. And I don't have time, I'm running out of time. So let me sum up. Wasteland or vacant land is not just a major phenomenon of the contemporary city, but it has an extended and complicated historical trajectory since the Middle Ages, if not before. It's often been a key part of the capacity, the resilience of cities to respond dynamically to crises, challenges and opportunities. Using vacant ground to develop new industries, to build new housing, to cope with demographic expansion, to erect flagship projects. But vacant land, and I haven't said very much about the use of vacant land for flagship projects, which is since the 1980s and 90s, but that really has to be, that's something I'm sure you have a lot of information on. But vacant land has also been an essential part of the narrative of ordinary people as a place for sociability, leisure, sex and crime, business activity and much else. Methodologically, the study of vacant land helps us to open up the exploration of the city from a new, less official perspective. Equally, it offers opportunities for sustained comparative and transnational analysis. Today I've covered only some of the many issues involved. More detailed research is needed, and we need to see how wasteland develops over time, and we need more information on the different types of wasteland. We also need more data on the actors involved in the generation of wasteland or vacant land. It's very important to see both the top down but also the bottom up factors, and no less important on the range of users. The attitude of the authorities needs to be investigated. Finally, I've only hinted at the differences between countries in the scale, origins, and policy attitudes towards vacant land. How far was climate a major variable affecting both its production and use, or were regional and national variations much more linked to economic trends and finance? So there is still much more, I think, to discover about urban wasteland and urban vacant land, and but now I have to stop, so thank you very much.